Today's webinar, Earn That Promotion Part 2, Getting Ahead in the Corporate World, sponsored by Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director here at Georgetown of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is John Kaiser, who is a business leadership coach. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in the questions in the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel screen. John is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component. We will also email out afterwards the PowerPoint slides that are shown during today's presentation. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. John Kaiser currently works with executives who recognize the need and have a passion for striving for continuous improvement, their own and their companies. In his coaching practice, he works with executives from CEOs to up-and-comers, helping them become even better at what they do in their leadership of others, becoming their best selves. John has had a long career as a senior executive with Johnson & Higgins, then after a merger with Marsh & McLennan. His principal responsibilities and his passions were superior client service, understanding specifically what his clients needed, and wanting all around the world and delivering to that standard, as well as training and developing his company's people so they can maximize their success. He is a believer in Tom Peters' principle, pay close attention to and take care of your people, and they will pay attention to and take good care of your clients. He subsequently joined nonprofit organizations, first as an executive director of the Cancer Research Foundation, and then as a head of development for the Georgetown University Medical Center. John is a Georgetown University liberal arts graduate and also a graduate of their leadership coaching program, which is accredited by the International Coaching Federation. I'd like to apologize. I think there might have been some confusion with what the start time was for today's webinar, so we hope that everyone on the line hasn't been inconvenienced and that you're able to still join us. Without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to John and thank him in advance for sharing his expertise and time with us today.
Hello, everyone. It is good to be with you all. Now, wait a moment. I'm trying to advance Emily. My PowerPoint will not advance. Could you?
All right. I'll be in. If you want to continue, okay. I'll be in there once.
Yeah. Okay. So let me tell you, I am I'm more interested in you than talking about myself. I do want to tell you, though, that ever since I graduated, I have been active with Georgetown, and that's been a source of a whole lot of enjoyment, but also has come in very, very handy. Been able to help lots of people through the Georgetown network, and it is pretty unique. And just a moment here. It's not advancing. Yeah, there we go. What did you do? I'm okay? Okay, good. So I encourage everyone to take advantage of the Georgetown Network. Stay involved when you go to reunion, special occasion, and talk to people you may not have known when you were at Georgetown. And some of my best friends now are people who were at Georgetown with me. You know, we barely knew each other at the time. But some unbelievable things can happen through the Georgetown Network. I met a young man who is a junior in the business school, and just in the course of conversation, I was talking about a friend of mine who was looking to make a career change, and he said, "Mr. Kaiser, I do some part-time work at an executive recruiting firm, a real high-level one in Washington, D.C. Why don't you have your friend, who happened to be a Georgetown alum, send his resume. I'll talk to the CEO of the firm and one thing or another. And Nothing came of that, but this young man jumped on it. And I've had so many similar experiences with Georgetown students, Georgetown alums, and Georgetown parents. My wife used to be the golf coach here, and I was with a buddy of mine whose two kids were at Georgetown one time, and I hung up the telephone from my wife, who was trying to recruit someone, but we needed some money. We didn't have a scholarship to offer. And he said, look, this is important to Georgetown, right? And the golf program. And I said, yeah. And he said, how much do you need? I'll take care of it. We had two other dads whose daughters came, and they said, whatever you need, just let me know. And you need internships for kids. You need a donation. You need me to help in any way possible. We've come to love Georgetown. So please, I encourage you to take advantage of that. It is real. In fact, one other quick story. A classmate of mine who I saw recently told me that his granddaughter is at Georgetown now. Actually, a student athlete. She plays varsity sport. He said she's real interested in China. She hopes to major and take a bunch of courses that relate to China because she's fascinated with it. So I saw this professor who's a friend of mine who I'll connect her with him. He's a great guy and very accessible. And so I didn't know his granddaughter. I sent her an email. We met at Starbucks on campus in the Levy Center last week. I said, tell me about your interest in China. She told me. I said, you got to meet Professor Lin. She just yesterday met him, and he has gotten her an internship at IBM in Shanghai this summer. And the family's thrilled. My classmates, you're unbelievable. The Georgetown network is unbelievable. Her dad, my friend's son, did not go to Georgetown. He went to Yale. At the time, he thought that was the right thing to do. Since then, after a number of visits to Georgetown, he has said, I wish I had known. I would have gone to Georgetown. The education is at least as good. It's fantastic education at Georgetown. And what is special about the place is the community that is Georgetown, be it students, faculty, administration, and the alums. And he said, the spirit at Georgetown is different than any other place I've ever seen. Okay, so that's about, encourage everyone to use it. It is very special, and you'll make great friends and get a lot of enjoyment out of it. Now let me go to that. So I work with high-level executives mainly, usually from CEO to vice presidents and people who are being groomed to become vice presidents, mid-level managers, and so on. And the difference between coaching and therapy, you know, spend a lot of time looking at the past. Give you a great example. A person who I'm working with now, a woman in her 40s, she's brilliant. And she has a big job with one of the top consulting firms in this area. She's in Northern Virginia. She wants to work on, she feels she is not at her best when she's in stressful situations where she feels a lot of pressure, either an important conversation with a high-level exec in the firm or with a client presentation or whatever. She feels like she does not think clearly. So we're talking about that, and I'm asking her, you know, well, why? What happens? And it turns out that in her mind, she was heavy when she was young. She felt she wasn't popular. She remembers never being chosen by the two captains for an athletic team. She was always the last one, and someone had to take her. who knows whether any of those things are true. They're true in her mind. And I said to her, hey, Lynn, you know, if you need to see a therapist or whatever, you need to talk about that, you know, go ahead. But here's what I suggest. Who is the person, the consultant that you would like to be? What is your vision of that consultant? And think about how that person thinks, how that person is received by others, and where are you compared to that person? What do you need to work on to improve to get to be that, in your mind, that role model? And we began to work very constructively. So it's about the future. It's about what are your dreams and who do you want to be and who's the leader you would like to become and so on. So the agenda today is I have some takeaways that are based on my 40 years of experience in the for-profit and the not-for-profit world that I think are helpful in getting ahead in an organization or corporate environment. And then, as Emily said, we'll handle some questions. This is a very important concept of the whole idea of self-reflection. Dean Manuel, Rob Manuel, one of the deans at Georgetown, gave me a book recently. It's called Heroic Leadership, and it's about the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits. And the Jesuits were founded in 1540, that is 461 years ago. And not only are they still going strong, their leaders, their leadership continues all around the world, in most countries in the world after 461 years. And let me tell you, there are few companies in the United States that are 100 years old. You would be shocked at how few companies in the United States are 100 years old. So here the Jesuits have been providing leadership for 461 years, and in this book it talks about when St. Ignatius started the Jesuits in 1540, he taught his people spiritual exercises. The foundation of those spiritual exercises is self-awareness, and of course self-awareness includes self-reflection. That's in essence what it is. But so self-awareness, it can be a whole lot of things, but certainly it's what are my values, what's important to me, and then in business it is so important, how am I received by others? So this is something I just encourage you to be aware of. How am I received by others? This is a key to leadership. I actually had a lunch just this couple of days ago on Monday of this week with Patrick Kilcar, who's head of, he's the director of personal development here at Georgetown University, an amazing guy, and a fellow by the name of John Fontana, a management consultant from Chicago who's in doing some ongoing work actually in here in District of Columbia. And we got into the subject of self-awareness and self-reflection, and Patrick said, you know, I believe in it. I know it's something I must do every day. My days are crazy. What I do driving home at night is I do not turn on the radio. I use that time for my self-reflection. And that was John Fontana said, what works for me is first thing in the morning, I get up and I spend some quiet time thinking about yesterday and today and you know, what's important for me to do and who's the person I want to be today. And then I do it again that night. So he said, I use self-reflection twice a day. So please, I encourage you to do that. It is especially important for leadership. The takeaways, this is earn that promotion is a continuation of one webinar we did on May 15th. And these were the things we discussed. And but there was a lot we didn't discuss, and that's what we're going to do today. I do need to tell you that after the last webinar, people were, you know, I said if you didn't get your question answered or if something pops up and you'd like to bounce off me, here's my email address, and feel free to, you know, to write to me with the issues or questions, and if I can answer, I offer an opinion, I certainly will. Every single one I heard from had an issue with their boss. So we're going to do actually a webinar, I think it's May 10th, that is called Managing Up. But it's about having a productive working relationship with your boss. It is so important because if you have a good relationship with your boss thinks you're great and you deserve to get ahead, that means a lot. So you know, I think I said something about in that last webinar, if you do not have a good working relationship with your boss, try your best to fix it. Get on the same page. Have the same agenda because it will help a lot. Also, a number of people who we heard from were women, and since then I've gotten a few more. So we're also going to do one on women. I had said in that webinar that certain principles of success that women are actually better than men in general at them and at these principles. For example, listening, for example, empathy, and being inclusive, and so on. So towards the end of June, we're going to do a dedicated webinar to women in business. So pretty good stuff. And guys, you should listen in too because the principles are really very, very similar. Okay, today, here are the takeaways I want to discuss today, and they are every bit as important as the ones that we discussed on May, February 15th. And I need to tell you that during that webinar, at this point, I said, just to make the whole thing interactive, I said, yeah, take 30 seconds and tell us which one. Email in which one you think is the most important. And everyone did that. And 60 seconds later, we had the answer. And I said, I'm sorry. It was really a trick question on my part because the answer is all of them are important. Every single one of these things is a critical success factor. So let's get into them then a little bit now. Being a doer and contributing ideas, and you see a problem, take care of it, fix it. If you see a problem you can't fix, offer ideas for how it can be fixed. So if you ask a boss what she or he wants and her people, it's going to be to get things done. You want someone who's a good teammate. You want someone who's contributing ideas. You want someone who makes things happen. And so I would encourage you to do that. I have all kinds of heroes in my mind who are doers, who contribute lots of things, who help people, and so on. I have to tell you, many of them, a great many, and the majority maybe, are Georgetown people. So that's kind of the nature of this community, I think, and I encourage you to be that way. And of course, growing the business, making things better. I mean, everyone wants their business to grow. You can't, in fact, your business can't stand still. It's either growing or it's losing ground. So growing is finding new opportunities and potential new clients, making service better, best ideas are bottom up. If you see something that is a process in your company and you can think of a better way to do it, well, contribute that idea. So that will be greatly appreciated. I was thinking about this. This is kind of a dumb example of being a doer, but I don't know why it popped into my head just actually as I was driving down here. One day when I was in Chicago, I used to live in Chicago, and I was out for a run I think it was a Sunday, and I was running on a trail through the woods, and I had my earphones, just listening to the radio, a sports program. And they were interviewing a former heavyweight champion, and he was talking. He had said Chicago used to be a great boxing center. It isn't anymore, but I'm putting on these boxing matches next Friday night, and hope to that begins to bring boxing back to Chicago. Now most of the big boxing matches are in Las Vegas or Atlantic City because of the casinos and stuff. So anyway, it kind of interests me. I thought to myself, wow, I'd like to be fun to go to those boxing things. But I missed where it was. All I heard was it's Friday night. So Monday morning, I opened up the telephone book, looked for this guy's, I assumed he had an office, and it was a long shot on my part, call the number expecting a secretary or administrative assistant or something or other, and this guy answers the phone himself. And so I said, well, I heard you, you don't know me, but I heard you interviewed yesterday when I was out for a run. I understand you're promoting some boxing matches in Chicago next Friday. I don't think I've ever been to a boxing match, but it'd be fun to go. I'd like to get some pals. How do I get tickets? And he said, I'll get you tickets. And we chat for a bit. And I said, I would love, I don't know much about boxing, but would you ever have lunch with me? And he said, sure. And I said, well, when are you free? And he said, I don't have any plans. I had lunch with him the next day. He had recently been the heavyweight champion of the world. So I mean, it was just like, is it dumb luck? Yeah, it is dumb luck, but again, the harder you work, the luckier you get. So it was kind of a thrill for me, and we had a great time. We ended up with ringside seats and all, but it was just by a phone call, and I had no idea it would work out the way it would, but I just took a chance, and there it was. So setting priorities, what matters the most? I am, this is a lesson for me, because one of the things I struggle with is you get so many emails and you can waste hours at your computer. Yeah, it's interesting stuff and so on, but did we get the right stuff done? Did we get the high potential items done? And so I'm going to preach to you about having a system. And I need a better system myself. This is a development need of mine. I used to get a ton of stuff done when I worked for a big company because I had an administrative assistant, and she was amazing. And she kept me going. But now that I'm on my own and I'm just fairly good at technology and stuff, I don't get nearly as much done. I know I don't get the right things done. And so, in fact, I was talking to someone who's a coach just yesterday about I feel overwhelmed. And he asked why, and I told him. And he He said, well, you got to do something about it. You can't put it off. And those of you who have positions where you can delegate, delegation is a good thing. You should do only what you have to do, and then give opportunities for success to other people. So if I encourage you to do that, and then whatever free time you have to spend that free time in conversations out of your office and around your office with your clients and stuff, and one-on-one and small group conversations. But one thing about delegation is if you ask someone to do something, don't micromanage. Give the person the result you want. If you want it done a certain way, do it. But don't second guess the person afterwards if they didn't do it the way you wanted it done. If they did it, the result is good, and just thank them. The other thing is, when you give work away, it is a good idea to follow up, not to micromanage, but just to let them know that you are appreciative and that it is important. So just, you know, a week or two later, just, how's it going? And they appreciate that. Otherwise, they feel like you just gave them work to get it away from you, that you're really not interested in it. You're happy to give it away to someone else, and it's not important to you. So do just ask the question, how's it going, and let them know that you're interested and appreciative. Goals. A great believer in goals, as I'm sure everyone is. And one of the things, I read a great book last year about the difference between performance goals and end goals, and why a performance goal is more valuable. And let me give you an example. Let's say I wanted a certain job in my company, to become the vice president in charge of the East Coast region, or vice president in charge of marketing, or whatever the job is. Doesn't make any difference. So that's my goal. I am consumed by getting that promotion. And you know what? You may not get it for whatever reason. Someone else may get the job because of politics, or because of, you know, a merger, and they need to find ways to use people from who are coming into the company or whatever. A much better approach is, okay, I want to become the vice president in charge of marketing. Now, how does that person act? How does that person look? How is that person received by others? What is that person's contribution to the company? What is that person's ideas? And so paint the picture of the person very likely that the senior management is looking for to fill that role the next time it needs to be filled. And how do you become that person? How do you think like that? How do you contribute like that? How do you lead people, and or how are you received by others? And that increases the likelihood that you will get that promotion. And you know what? If you don't get it, something else is going to happen. If you have become that good of a leader and a contributor, there'll be something else that happened. And maybe, you know, some firm will try offer you a great opportunity outside your whatever. But so becoming the person that you think would be the ideal candidate, good things will happen to you. So, and in this book I read, the fellow is the author is a business leadership consultant now, but at one time in his life he had been a tennis pro, teaching pro, and he talked about having someone who, her goal shouldn't be to win Wimbledon because she could lose the title on a bad call, or she could, you know, be twist her ankle, or but he said her goal, the things that I encouraged her to become, is so good that she would win Wimbledon. And so if she didn't win Wimbledon, she would win the U.S. Open or something like that. So that's the thing, that she wouldn't, if she lost on a bad call, she would feel real good about how good she had become, what the level of play. And now, writing a plan. I think I talked about this briefly on the webinar on February 15th, but the importance of writing a plan, and please, this is so important. I read a study, a research study last year, that said when a person has an idea, there's a 10% chance that he or he will follow through on the idea. 10%. If a person has an idea and writes a plan to execute it, it's an action plan or a business plan, the likelihood of the person following through goes from 10% to 50% just by writing the plan. It doesn't have to be a 30 or 40 page business plan. It just, so long as taking the time to write a thoughtful business plan, it can be 2 or 3 pages, it can be a 30 or 40 pages, but just taking the time to think through and put in writing a plan that increases the likelihood from 10 to 50%. And then, if a person writes a plan, has the idea, writes the plan, and holds themselves accountable to someone, could be to her boss, could be to her colleagues, could be to a coach, could be to a spouse, best friend, a peer, but just holds themselves accountable to someone, says, this is my plan, I intend to execute it by such and such a date, please follow up with me, ask me how I'm doing, and make me accountable to you. It goes to 95%. So from 10% to 90% by writing the plan and holding ourselves accountable. So that's powerful. Okay, conversations. We've all heard that money is not the main motivator for people in business, and studies after studies after studies have proven that, not that money isn't important, we all want to be paid fairly. And some people it's absolutely imperative because of whatever the circumstances is. So, for example, I am a believer in, as a boss, pay the people as well as you can, take money off the table, and then do all the other things. But you can pay people a lot, but if you don't do the other things, you are vulnerable, they could leave. So, you know, the main things, for main motivators for people are feeling appreciated, feeling they're part of a team, that their ideas matter, that they're heard. And what better way than conversation? So to me, conversations are the heart of a great organization, a great company or organizational esprit de corps, spirit, or culture. In fact, on my website, I write a weekly post, and the one that is currently up is about a company culture that is collaborative, supportive, loyal, enthusiastic, high-spirited, high energy, and so on. And it is, we had a reunion, and people talked to me about what made the difference for us is we all had so many conversations. We wanted to know what our goals were, what our problems were, Some of us got into family stuff. Others didn't want to get into family stuff. But we took the time to ask one another open-ended questions. The boss would ask open-ended questions, listen, not interrupt, listen to learn, to understand, and so on, to establish rapport, to let people know you care. And I say here, it gains alliance, support, friendships, strong working relationships. All of that is absolutely true. So please, conversations are absolutely key to being successful and to being a leader. And talk about leadership. Leadership is not a title. It's each of us is a leader. A leader is getting another person or persons to do the right thing. And that's what we can all do to help other people do their best. Everyone wants to do well. Everyone wants to succeed. Some people wrestle with insecurity or afraid to admit they don't know something, afraid to ask questions, and that's going to get in the way. But we as a colleague or as a boss or as a peer, or even if we're, you know, with the person we report to, can help influence the person and to do the right thing and be encouraging, inspiring, instill confidence, and do it in a quiet, nice way. And it's a way to feel really good about yourself at the end of the day. And if you feel really good about yourself, the chances of success are greatly improved. Another takeaway, of course, is being a presence in our community. Our own, you know, helping with our own visibility and our company's visibility, and being respected matters. And in fact, it matters the most to the high-level executives. Not that it doesn't matter to everyone, but if you're active in the community, in a charity or some worthy cause or something, and the president of the company finds out, he's gonna take notice, or she's gonna take notice, or whatever. But so this is a good thing to do, and again, it falls under the category of the harder you work, the luckier you get. I might have told the story in the last webinar when I was in Chicago. I got involved. Someone asked me to go on the board of the International Theater Festival of Chicago. And so I said, yeah, sure, I'll go. I like the theater. I mean, I like musicals and that kind of stuff, or mysteries. And when I got to the first board meeting, I was totally weak-kneed because they were talking about playwrights that I had never heard of, and I didn't open my mouth. I went to three meetings. I never once opened my mouth other than at the first meeting I introduced myself. I never said in these three meetings, I couldn't contribute, so I wasn't going to say anything dumb. So I just sat there, took notes, looked interested, and literally, that's not an exaggeration. So after the third meeting, that following week, someone comes into the office and says, hey, John, great going. We just got this new client, and I knew we were working on it, and it was a big client, about, well, it was more than $200,000 in income to us. And he said, the vice president of finance said, we got to give this to Johnson & Higgins because John Kaiser, who runs the office here, is a winner. He was on that board with me. I had not said one word. Not one word other than my name is John Kaiser. And just because I was a presence in the community, he assumed I was a winner. Little did he know. But, I mean, that goes under the importance of being visible. And also, as I said, the harder you work, the luckier you get, because we had no business getting that piece of business for that reason. So, soft skills. You know, I assume virtually everybody on this call is a Georgetown grad and is highly intelligent, good at what they do. And let me tell you, there are lots and lots of people who are highly intelligent, dedicated, hardworking, good at what they do. And so I think that's a given. What can be the difference maker are the soft skills. People like to do business with people they like, people they want to do business with, and I think it is very, very important the way we present ourselves, comfortable eye contact, good handshake, smile, showing we care, really genuinely care, letting people we are interested, that they matter to us, a quick walk, the way we sit up, the way we ask people about how they're doing, what, how they're feeling, everything okay at home, did your mother recover from that surgery, how are your kids, they get hits at the baseball game, but just being a good person, a good teammate, can I help you with anything, all those things matter. The best way to be promoted is to be promoted by your peers, by becoming the most valuable player. And the soft skills really do matter. And I had said in the earlier seminar, being early, I don't know whether being early is a soft skill, but it is critically important. So always try and be early. The other thing that we should probably spend the webinar on is remembering names. Not easy to do, but you can learn to do it. And I'm not real good at it, but I'm a whole lot better than I used to be because I know how important it is, and I read about it. Look, there's good stuff on the webinar, helpful tips to remembering names. And so I encourage you to do that. If anyone wants, send me an email. I wrote a paper about this, and I'd be happy if anyone wants to, I'll send it to you. But it really makes a difference when you meet someone and they can call you by the name and maybe even remember your kids' names or your spouse's name or remember other things. It's impressive. For those of you who are at Georgetown, when Father O'Donovan was the president, he was amazing at remembering names. You could, Leo O'Donovan could have met your spouse 20 years ago, and you see him 20 years later, and he asks about her by name. I had never met anyone with a greater memory than Father Leo had, so please work on that. So these are the takeaways we discussed today. After the webinar in February, someone got hold of me that afternoon and said, hey, thanks, that was really good. I've taken the takeaways, and I think she said she was going to laminate them, but she put them over her desk, this page, but it was the takeaways for the earlier webinar. And I said, that's great. And she said, well, I want to see him every day. And I said, that's great, but they aren't the only takeaways. There are other things. So if anyone wants the, put both up, the ones from the February 15th takeaways and these as well, because these are equally as important. Now, Emily, who has organized this webinar, said to me that she thought that something people would want to hear about today is there seemed to be a bunch of interest in how do you ask for a raise, and that was under the heading of the bosses. And so we're gonna devote the webinar in May to the subject of having the relationship, a productive relationship with the boss. But asking for a raise, here's the best way to do it, in my opinion. I might be being paid what the position calls for. Maybe there's a factor for how long I've been with the company or something, but it's not easy to give arbitrary raises. My suggestion is to go to the boss and say, I've been thinking I would like to earn more money, and here's what else I can do. Here are other responsibilities I can take on, other contributions I can make to the company, which I hope would enable you to give me more money and salary. So I would go to your boss with not just the request, but also with the solution. And that is by, I can do more work, I can do more, take on more responsibilities, I can increase my contributions, and if I do that, could you pay me more money? So that should be well received, and I had a real live example of that just last week with someone who I was talking with and was kind of stuck. They said, I can't get more money because I said it's not in the budget, and there was an open position, so I said, could you say to your boss, you can take on some of the responsibilities of that open position. They may still have to fill it, but they can fill it with a person at a lower level and save some money there and give that money to you. And she said, that is a great idea. I'm going to approach it that way. That should work. I haven't heard whether it did work because she hasn't had that conversation yet, but she was excited about it and believed it would. So I've talked for about 45 minutes, and I'm going to get to some questions now, but if your questions are not answered, please feel free, or you want to raise something that comes up next week or so, feel free to email me, and I'll try and get back to you with any advice or information that might be helpful to you. So I don't know whether there's anything else to talk about or we should end. So if there are, Emily, if there are questions, we can talk about
now. Sure, we have a couple questions. Yeah, we have a couple questions that have come through, and I just want to remind everyone on the line to please submit their questions through the question area of their GoToWebinar control panel screen. John, someone wants to know, and they definitely are fine with you omitting names, but if you could tell maybe a success story of someone that you've coached and how they've been able to move up the ranks and become promoted through using these techniques.
So one situation I have is a person brought me in to coach each of the members of the executive committee, and he wanted to back off and spend less time on internal stuff and be able to spend more time out clients and helping to grow the company by attracting new clients and stuff. So this was a year ago. Well, it started in January of 2010. And by the end of the year, each of these people, one guy had, in this case, they all happened to be men, but more than half of my clients are women. But in this particular client situation, they were all men. One guy, very smart, very quick mind, and he tended to interrupt people, finish people's sentences. He was unaware of it. And people felt he didn't care because he was so quick. They felt he wasn't a good listener and didn't care about him. And once he became aware of that, we got into some self-observation practices. All of a sudden, he slowed down. He would listen with care, and people got people felt he changed. It takes a while to change perception. So if someone thinks Jim is not a good listener, and Jim all of a sudden, you know, works on being a good listener immediately, it's going to take months for that perception to change, where people begin to realize, hey, he is a different person. He is listening. He does care. So that was one example. The example I gave about the woman who is a consultant, a management consultant with one of the major firms, where she has gotten under control her nervousness when in stressful situations. And what she does now is ahead of the meeting or ahead of the conversation, she would just write down it, almost in bullet points, the message that she wants to convey. So that's it there. She doesn't run her mouth off. She knows exactly what message she wants to deliver. She delivers it and then uses silence to let people process it, to let them feel that she's giving them the time to think about. And it kind of shows a quiet confidence to state what you want to state, and then to have the quiet confidence to let the person think and just maintain comfortable eye contact and so on. A couple of clients, you know, just want a thinking partner outside their company, someone who they trust and know will maintain the confidentiality. And they said, you know, this is, I'm having a problem with this employee, and I won't tell them what to do, but I'll just ask questions, you know, like, how do you think you can best solve that? What is an alternative? And how do you think the person's going to react if you do this? How do you think the person will realize you're trying to be constructive if you do it a different way? And you know, how can you set the stage so the person is receptive? So, I mean, I just ask questions, and good people get even better. Some people want to work on a development need, and we all have things that we can do better. And you know, I think I said before that humility is the foundation of growth. Maybe I said that in February, but humility is the foundation of growth. To me, the secret to success in moving ahead in an organization and in being a leader is striving for continuous improvement, to say, you know what, I'm pretty good at what I do, but I know I can be better. I know I can try and be better each and every day. And to me, the people that don't do that, it's because they're insecure. They don't want to admit they're vulnerable. They don't want to admit they don't know something. So they don't ask the question. They don't ask what success looks like. So I hope that is, you know, email me again if you want more illustrations. But, you know, so far I think everybody I've worked with has feel that they have gotten better. And I had a coach in my business, and she helped me. She was amazing. And you don't have to have a, you know, executive coach or a business coach. I mean, just can ask colleagues to help you what you're working on. And that's not a sign of weakness. That's a sign of security. If you say to the person who you work closely with, you know, here's what I think I can do better, please keep an eye on me. Let me know how I'm doing. Emily, we have another one.
Thank you so much. Yeah, we have another one, John. Someone wants to know how you suggest dealing with a situation in which someone might have made a mistake or taken on too much work, and they need to correct the situation in order to be perceived in a positive light, to then hopefully be up for promotion later on.
Yeah, that is a great question, and it's a difficult situation. But you know, I have to believe that honesty is always the best approach to anything, and I do believe that sitting down with one's boss and saying, I want to do the very best I can. I'm a little bit concerned, or I'm very concerned, that I've got so much to do that some of the things, I'm not trying to avoid doing work. I just want to make sure that what I do is high caliber, top level. I want to do everything promptly, correctly, to the best of my ability. And I need to tell you that I'm a little bit concerned that having so much may jeopardize my ability to deliver to that. What do you think? And so it's not like trying to get out of work. It's being honest and saying I'm a little bit concerned that there's so much here. I might let something suffer, and I know that, I need to be a hard worker. We all do, and that's the business world we live in today. But I think honesty is the best approach, and hopefully the boss will be constructive and discussing it with you.
Great. Thanks so much. The other question we have, John, is related to a timeline. Do you have, I know it's kind of a tough question to answer, but in your mind, is there a specific time period that someone needs to wait before they are hoping for a promotion? How soon is too early, or how early is too soon, rather, for someone to go ahead and hopefully ask for one or work towards one?
Yeah, and that, I don't think I can answer that because it's going to vary by corporation and the job and or the organization and so on. But so there isn't an answer, a general answer to that. But I do think there is absolutely nothing wrong with letting one's boss know, or HR people or whatever, that, hey, I am ambitious. I want to get ahead. I know I need to earn it. So I'm not asking for any special treatment, but, I do want to get ahead, and I do want to earn it, and I'm asking for ideas, and please keep your eye on me, and if you see ways I can improve or additional responsibilities I can take on, please keep me in mind. So I know I read one article recently where someone said you can't ask the boss, tell the boss that you are interested in her job, because that might make the boss nervous. But say, I would like to someday have a job with responsibilities similar to what you have. Would you please give me any feedback so that I can earn that kind of a role? So I think it's just letting people know that you do want to get ahead. I don't think you want to necessarily do that week one, but I don't think you have to be in a job too long. As long as you're doing real good work and you're a hard worker and you're contributing ideas and you're a great teammate, to letting your boss and human resources know that you do want to get ahead and you want to earn it, and to please give you feedback.
Thank you. Well, we have time for one more question, and I think this probably can be related to a lot of people on the line. With all of the budgets being frozen and a lot of companies being really not as generous, or it's more difficult, I think, for people to, when they sometimes are promoted, to get a significant raise or a salary that matches that increase in responsibility. What are your thoughts on that? If someone was given some type of promotion at work, but it really, the salary that went along with that didn't match the increase of responsibility, what do you think you would suggest for someone to do in that situation?
Well, again, I'm sympathetic to the situation, but the fact of life today is that, the budget increases are slim because of the financial situation, the environment that we're in. So this must be a very, very common problem. And the only approach that I can think of is to offer to do, even look for ways that you can help the company grow, and say if I can, I do need to make more money, I want to earn thinking about other things I can do that would help this company. And maybe that will work. Other than that, I mean, I just think, you know, we're in a time period where budgets are for increases, you know, they're 2-3% type things, and that's not going to get us very far. The cost of living goes up at least that much. But that's the environment we're in. So all I can say is try and think of ways that you can give them a reason to pay you more. And just do as great a job as you can, and hopefully you can make the money in the present company if it's a company you love. And hate to see people switch just purely because someone offers them, you know, 15,000 or some attractive number more. Sometimes you're going to have to do it. And but it's just the environment we're in. So I'd try and work it out with your own company if you can, if you like the people, you're in a culture that you like, and you know, if you can think of ways that give them a reason to enables them to pay you more money, great. That's what I'd try and do. Okay, so this has been, I hope it's been helpful for everyone. I've enjoyed doing it. I love to help Georgetown people, and so please do not hesitate to be in touch if there's anything you'd like to bounce off me or question or whatever. And I'm sorry if some of the answers aren't like, how do you get a raise when there is no money? I wish I had a better answer for that, but that's all I can tell you. But please, I don't hesitate to be in touch. And again, those takeaways, those are good things about every one of those things will help in our career. So please process that stuff. Think about it. It really will help. I promise you, that's based on 40 years of experience, and I know that those things are true. So, okay, everyone, I hope it was helpful. I certainly wanted it to be. Maybe I'll talk to you at a future webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, John. This has been great. And just to remind everyone, we'll be sending out the slides and details on how to access the recording. And we hope you'll join us on Tuesday, May 10th for John's next upcoming webinar, The Art of Managing Up. Thanks so much again, John, for sharing your expertise and time. And thanks to everyone on the line for listening. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, Emily.